First, I just want to say how much of a privilege it is to be here at the CHS and also to be able to present to this group today. And before I share my slides, I'd like to ask you if I'm being unclear, just interrupt and ask me to clarify. But please save, you know, sort of interesting questions and comments for the end. Okay, I'm going to try to screen share now with sound. Okay, can you see this?
Perfect.
Okay, great. All right, so the title of the presentation is Tonal Ochlophobia in Greek, Evidence from the Musical Documents. And I'll start out with a quick overview. So first I'm gonna make some preliminary remarks on Greek accentuation in the musical documents. Much of this will be familiar to many of you. And then second, I'm going to try to show you an example that illustrates how I think further study of the musical text can shed light on some features of Greek accentuation and its development. And then third, I'm going to show you a second example that I'm currently looking into, which may involve what I'm calling tonal ochlophobia for fun. And let's see. And so as a point of departure, so I'm interested in Greek accentuation and how it's related to the grammar of the language. I think of it as sort of a window into the grammar. And I'm interested in how that system evolved over time, especially characteristic developments, sort of special Greek features, such as the circumflex accent, the restriction of the accent to the final two or three syllables, which is called the law of limitation, recessive accentuation, and the association of word final acute with certain case forms, nominative and accusative, and circumflex with others, genitive and dative, which we see in pairs like foras, genitive singular, versus accusative plural, foras, with an acute. And then briefly, just you know, sort of the general consensus on the sound of the accent. So the acute accent in ancient Greek marked high pitch. The grave accent marked highish pitch. So it's a bit lower than the acute, but higher than unaccented syllables. And the circumflex marked a high to low falling pitch. And part of the evidence for this comes from the musical documents. So interestingly, in non-strophic vocal music, the movement of the musical melody respects the accents of the words. And this was noted long ago already. And probably the two best examples of this, where it's especially clear, are the so-called Delphic paeans, or the Delphic hymns. And this very much surprised me the first time I read about it, but it turns out that across the languages of the world, it's not particularly unusual at all, especially in tone languages. We find a similar kind of tone to tune correlation. And so I've cited a very nice recent paper in language by Laura McPherson and Kevin Ryan, who did a study of tone-tune association in Tomoso folk songs, that's a Dogon language, and they cite a lot of the more general literature on these traditions there, if you're curious. Okay, just briefly on the Delphic paeans, so they were performed in 127 BCE at the Pythiad Festival at Delphi by two Athenians, Athenaeus and Laminius, who belonged to a guild of musicians, poets, and actors housed at Athens, which Laminius refers to in his paean essay, techni ton hesmos. And although they're astrophic, they are articulated into distinct musical and also metrical paragraphs. And metrically, rhythmically, they're paeonic, except for the closing prayer in Laminius's composition, which is in Aeolic rhythm. And each of them celebrates, as was of course traditional, the foundational myth of the Pythian sanctuary, Apollo's slaying of the serpent that had occupied the place. And here's just a quote from Laminius's paean. So, Pydagos tepephnes iois, you slew the son of earth with your arrows. So this is the second musical paragraph of Athenaeus's paean, which was sung, of course, and accompanied by both the allos and the kithara. And this is how it looks when it's transcribed from the inscription. And so you can see that there are, you can see the musical notation above the words, and the musical notation, the symbols are derived from alphabetic signs. So as you can see, the first one looks like a gamma, the second one looks like an upside down omega, and so forth. And the convention at this point, and in the Hellenistic documents generally, is that if a series of notes is to be sung, sorry, a series of syllables is to be sung to the same note, you only write the note sign over the first of them. So it, while it looks like there are only four notes written over the first line nine here, you can just sort of copy them rightward as until you get to the next note sign. Okay. And here's the same paragraph transcribed into modern staff notation. So ein kluta megalopolis atis, low famous great citied Attica, etc. And this is of course easier to read for lay people like me. The standard edition of the musical documents, which is usually abbreviated DAGM, is that by Iga Kuman and Martin West, Documents of Ancient Greek Music. And you can listen to the melodies on the web, well, in various places, but I recommend this this page that Stefan Hage has produced. He is an expert in this area, unlike me. And now I'd like to take a couple of minutes and listen to one of these, listen to Athenaeus's paean. So hopefully this will work. If it doesn't, let me know. Let's see. Does everybody see this website of his now where it says the melodies and there's a kithara and stuff? Okay, and so here they are. And I'm gonna go to this one. This is Athenaeus's paean and click on this. And you should hear it start to play in just a second. Thank you. And so that was the first paragraph. And now I just want to listen to the second one too. That's the one that we just saw the text of. And it gets much more chromatic, as you'll hear. Okay, and so returning now to the generalizations about the sort of correlation between the musical melody and the accents, these are usually presented as three rules or generalizations. I've just chosen Philemon Probert's relatively recent formulation of them because I like the way that she words it, but you'll find these standardly in other works, such as Martin West's book on ancient Greek music, and of course older work as well. So the accented syllable of a word, and this, by the way, includes acute, circumflex, and grave, is usually sung on a note no lower than that of any other syllable in the word. So going forward, I'm going to call this tied for highest. B, on long vowels that take two notes, that is to say, when you have a melism, the first note is usually higher if the syllable has a circumflex, but the second note is usually higher if the syllable has an acute. C, a final syllable with a grave accent, as written in our printed texts, is sung on a note no higher than the accented and pre-accented syllables of the following word. And so now I've collected some examples from the Delphic paeans for us. So we saw it at the beginning of the second paragraph, ein megalopolis atis. And so you can see that megalopolis is mapped are set such that the syllable lo is set to the highest note. So this is what it sounds like. Megalopolis. Sorry, I can't sing. Bathu dendron gives us a nice example of tied for highest. So the accented syllable thu or tu is tied for highest with the first syllable, and this is what it sounds like. Okay. Yes. Okay. And so now we come to B. This is the one that has to do with the melisms, that is to say, cases where one syllable is set to two notes. And this, by the way, is only possible for heavy syllables that are what we as classicists usually call long syllables. So I've underlined the syllable that's set to two notes here, and I've underlined the two notes here on the right. So for techni, tone, tone is set to FE, to a falling melism as a circumflex. It sounds like this. Techni, tone, falling. Recall that if an acute accented syllable is set to a melism, it's usually rising. So this is how the setting of ife sounds. So ite, something like that. And so if you're wondering, how do you know when a particular syllable is mapped to or set to two notes? There are various ways to figure it out, but in the Delphic paeans, it's very easy because in the inscription, those syllables are actually written in a special way. So techni tone with a melism on the final syllable is written techni to on. Oidaisi with a melism on the penultimate syllable is written oidaisi, and so forth. Okay, and then finally the special rule for the growl. So recall that like the other two accents, it is tied for highest, but it's not allowed to be higher than the following pre-accented or accented syllables. So if we look at this first example, so hos ana di korumba, you see that, you know, hos and ana, you get this whole kind of flat sequence. The grave on ana set to E flat is indeed lower than the following G and accented A flat. And I'll skip to the final example here. Le goût de l'otos bremon, something like the pipe braying loud and clear. I'm referring to the alos. Sounds like this. Le goût de l'otos bremon. And that gives you an example of a heavy syllable with a melism rising, a melism that doesn't contain a long vowel, but it is heavy by position. And so there you see the grave on le goût is actually the highest, not just tied for highest, but the highest in its word. It's remains sort of at that level over de, and then again you get a little rise to the grave in low toss, and that C though is of toss, but the grave is still lower than the following accent itself. Okay, so these generalizations are standard by now, we can do more. So the musical melody does not just correlate with pitch and accented syllables, but with the pitch movement of the language more generally. And so that makes it possible to reconstruct more of that. For example, the way that pitch rises up to an accent or the way that it falls after an accent. And that's been, to my mind, impressively demonstrated in the fourth chapter of Devine and Stevens' book, The Prosody of Greek Speech, which I find very difficult and also very worthwhile reading. I've chosen one example, and so they have a collection of studies that go beyond the generalizations that we were just talking about. And this one has to do with what they call the post-accentual kink. So I quote, the results of these tests, that is to say a couple of tests that they just did, are represented schematically in figure 4.5, which shows a steady rise to the peak, followed by an abrupt drop over the first post-peak mora and a slower flatter fall over subsequent post-peak mori. Okay, and here is the schematic figure, and I've drawn an arrow to the kink. And so basically this kind of reconstructs the movement of pitch up to the accented syllable, the peak here, and then the movement of pitch back down afterwards. And you can see that going sort of the pre-accentual rise is very smooth, but the post-accentual fall is much steeper immediately after the accent, and then it sort of flattens out a bit after that. And this is not necessarily how things work in all languages. So they're good examples of smooth falls and other kinds of configurations. And so this is where sort of the phonologist gets excited and gives us a bit of an interpretation. And so what Devine and Stephen suggest is that, they write, this suggests the following possible phonological interpretation of the overall accentual fall. The accentual peak and fall, sensu stricto, is a high-low tone combination. And so in the right-hand column, I try to give you a kind of interpretation of this, or by exemplifying it, actually. So for recessively accented words like finite verbs, this would mean that the acute that we see written is actually the first half of a high plus low tone combination. So something like legomen has a kind of dual tone or a tone duo. What we see written is the first half of it. This may sound completely crazy to you, but it doesn't seem very weird to me. This sort of stuff is pretty standard in the phonology of pitch and tone. The reason that they posit this is to capture the post-accentual kink that we just talked about, which is reflected in the musical documents. I think that one of the reasons why I'm attracted to this suggestion is that I think we can kind of synthesize it with two other ideas and fill out an account of the evolution of recessive accentuation, which is a kind of a special characteristic feature of Greek accentuation. And so I want to combine this with some recent work by Philemon Probert on the development of the law of limitation with a kind of particular analysis of Greek word rhythm that lots of people have contributed to recently. I'll treat these in order. And this is just, you all are familiar with this, but I'm worried about being too Anglo-centric, at least in terms of the terminology here. So the law of limitation is what we call, the rule that if the final syllable is light, the accent can't fall further from the end of the word than the antepenultimate syllable. And if it's heavy, it can't fall further from the end of the word than the penultimate syllable. Just as a reminder, the law of limitation kind of ignores one word final consonant if it's present. So anthropos can be accented on the antepenultimate syllable as if it has a light final syllable. So it's sort of like the law just ignores that final sigma, and it's as if the final syllable were just pu. If there are two final consonants, it can't recede to the antepenal. Okay, and recessive accentuation is what we call the type of accentuation where the accent falls as far from the end of the word as permitted by the law of limitation. And so, as you all know, entire classes of words are recessive, finite verbs, neuter third declension nouns, certain types of compounds, and then, of course, individual lexical items. Okay, and so I think there's a very interesting, this paper by Philemon Probert on the development of the law of limitation, which is in the Festschrift for John Penny, is very, very interesting. And so this is sort of her conclusion. So she suggests that a large proportion, probably a majority, of early Greek word tokens obeyed the law of limitation before this law was even in force. They did so in such a way that if the position of the accent was reckoned from the end of the word, the law of limitation was suggested especially strongly. The accent fell on the penultimate syllable in forms with a heavy final syllable, and on the antepenultimate in trisyllabic or longer forms with a light final syllable. And so the idea is that the law of limitation would have evolved via what she writes, the analysis of existing forms followed by the extension of a new regularity extracted from these forms. So here's an example. So if we take an early Greek paradigm of Lego, at the stage when the verb is accented on the root, I mean, that was the rule at this point, accent verbs like this on the root, on leg. But nevertheless, if you look at the present indicative active paradigm here, you can see that their accentuation happens to already be recessive in accordance with the law of limitation. So this isn't true of all forms in the paradigm. So something like first plural middle would have been legomata, not later legomata. But it's true for the vast majority of the forms. Turning to the Greek word rhythm, so I subscribe to the view that there's a rhythmic constituent at the end of Greek words, which is unfortunately called a foot, and that makes it can get us mixed up with feet and meter, but that's not what I mean. And it consists of either two light syllables or one heavy syllable. So it would, the constituent in legate would be geta, and the constituent in lego would be go. Those would be the feet at the end of these words. And there's evidence for this from word formation and also from meter. And additionally, from the accent, but that would be somewhat circular for the argument that I'm making here. So, and then note that there's a special case, words that end with a heavy light sequence are special. So something like legusi or earlier legonti. What do you do there? Well, you either end up with an unfooted syllable at the end of the word, or you have a foot that consists of both a heavy and a light syllable, and is sort of one more bigger than the sort of foot you're shooting for. And so this type of foot in phonology is called a moraic troche, and many languages lend themselves to an analysis of their word rhythm with moraic troches. Okay, so if we assume that the foot, the moraic troche, already existed at the stage just before the law of limitation and recessive accentuation arose, it just so happens that the accent immediately precedes it. So you have leg go, leg gaze, leg gay, leg geton, leg geton, legomen, or legomes, legete, legonti. And so the idea is that the post-accentual fall in pitch, which we were just looking at, happens to coincide with this foot. And so what I would suggest is that speakers reinterpreted the fall as being part of the accent, whence the high plus low tone combination, and simultaneously reinterpreted the accent as tied to the word rhythm rather than the morphological root, whence recessive accentuation. Oops, Okay, and so just to sort of give you an interim summary, I'm just suggesting that a kind of close study of the musical documents tells us more about pitch movement in Greek, and that invites some phonological analysis, which can at least potentially shed light on some salient features of the language and how they developed. So we can more or less see from the musical documents that there is a kink in the post-accentual fall that can be taken to point to a high plus low tone combination. And that high plus low tone combination would link the inherited high, most of the acute of the, you know, tied morphologically to the root and the paradigm that we were just looking at originally, with the word final foot and recessively accented paradigms. Okay, just a very brief second example. This is the one that I've started working on. So another interesting observation based on the musical documents is that in Greek, the turning point between falling and rising tone coincides with the word boundary. The word boundary is demarcative. And so I should mention that this is also not necessarily the case in languages. And in Vedic Sanskrit, where we can see where the where that sort of turning point is, thanks to the way that accentuation is notated, it is not tied to word boundary. So it can occur in the word that follows the accent and so forth. And that's not just interesting as a typological comparison, but also because the Greek system of accentuation developed from one that was very similar to the one that's preserved in Vedic Sanskrit. So, and then the phonological interpretation, some data suggests that this could be formalized by positing a boundary low tone at the end of the word. Okay, so if substantiated, I think this word final or word plus enclitic final low tone could help explain some features of Greek accentuation, including the so-called sotera rule, which at least from a historical perspective, converts the acute accent of a long vowel penultimate syllable to a circumflex if the vowel of the final syllable is short. So you see the kind of inherited acute in soter, genitive plural soteron, versus the innovative circumflex in soteros, where the vowel of the final syllable is short, and in sotera, where it's likewise short. I think it could also help explain the conversion of word final acute to grave accents, phrase internally, and possibly have played a role in other accent retraction processes such as Wheeler's law. And so this is where tonal crowding avoidance comes in. So if you sort of look at the phonological literature in this, and specifically types where there's crowding between a high tone and a following low tone, I think we can say this. If speakers have to execute the transition from a high tone to a low tone over a short span, which is hard, they may ease the transition in several ways. And they include realizing the peak a little earlier, which gives them more time or more space to execute the transition. And this, I think, is probably how the sotera rule came about. So you had sotera with an acute, and that changes to sotera. And you can basically understand the change as the retraction of the peak of the high point from relatively late in the vowel to relatively early in the vowel. And that gives you more room to execute the fall from that high to this putative low tone at the end of words or word groups. And a second way that speakers ease the transition is to realize the peak a little bit lower so that the transition from high to low is less steep. And I think this is maybe the best way to understand the rule that converts word final acutes to graves, phrase internally. So basically just a lowering that makes the transition from that high tone to the boundary low tone easier. And so I'm beginning to think about, well, what would the evidence for music look like for this? And I think we would expect melodic troughs, so notes immediately preceded and followed by a higher note, to regularly coincide with word end, since melodic troughs should reflect pitch troughs in speech, at least kind of in the aggregate. And secondly, if they do, we would need to make sure that the coincidence can't be attributed to chance or other factors such as the proximity of preceding and following accents. The idea there being, you know, that if all else is equal, you want to space these sequences of an accent, a trough and a following accent out relatively evenly rather than crowding them together. Okay, and so to check that, I'm putting together a corpus, which needs to include a bunch of stuff, which I'm still figuring out, obviously notes and note values. We need syllables, that certainly needs to include vowel length and all the other relevant phonological information, and accents, word and phrase boundaries, and metrical boundaries. And so an excerpt of part of it might look like this. So this is what Ligude Lotos Bremon would look like. So you can see that each line in the table represents a note. So DAGM just tells you which document it is, line, we can forget that, that's sort of the locus. And then this is an A flat, value one tells me it's essentially what's transcribed as an eighth note. Here's the syllable Li. It's not accented and there's no juncture. The second one would be Gu, and it is accented with a grave, and it's followed by the juncture between a lexical word and a functional word, da, and so forth. So that's sort of what it will look like. It'll be bigger than that. And yeah, and so where I am currently is expanding the corpus to include more of the musical documents and further information. We probably want to mark proper names because they seem to be kind of treated very ornamentally, or mapped to very ornamental melodies. We want to at least be able to identify them. And maybe also syllables or words at the beginning of a musical piece where there may have been a sort of customary incipit of starting with a rising fifth, which may kind of override the melody accent correlation, and also experimenting with different ways of measuring the distance between troughs and peaks. So what I'm calling vertical distance, do we want to do that in hertz or semitones? And what I'm calling horizontal distance, whether we want to sort of measure it in syllables or in mori or sonorant consonants in the syllable rhyme or vowels and glides only, etc. And so that's sort of where things stand. And at this point, I did put some references in the things that I referenced. And I'm happy to share the slides with anyone who's interested, and I'm even happier to take questions.